Father, we just thank you, Lord.
Amen.
We can sing them words this morning, and we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. And we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to us, Lord, over and over again.
And
Lord, we just welcome you to our meeting this morning.
Yes,
we just pray, Lord, as the praise and worship team, Lord, would lead us unto your praise and worship, Lord. We just pray that you'll take us unto new realms with you. And Lord, for the one that take up your word, Lord, we just pray. Anoint the pages, Lord, and anoint the words. In Jesus' name, we just pray, Lord, for the ones who cannot make it this morning, Lord. We just pray, Lord, be with them, Lord, and be unto them, Lord. And let them know, Lord, that we have been praying for them, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for everything that you're doing, Lord. And we just welcome you into this meeting this morning. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Not by works, but by your grace. Wonderful. deeper than I've ever known. You have set my feet where I belong. You break within my heart a brand new song.
Yes.
You gave me a love, offered my life a brand new start. You gave me a love sent straight from heaven to my heart.
Done in my life.
You've been so kind and patient with me over and over again. When I have strayed, you've shown me the way over and over again. All I can say is I love you. All I can say is I need you. All I can say is I thank you, Lord, for all that you've done in my life. In my life, Lord, be glorified. Be Lord, never runs dry. So come now, come to the waters, all who are thirsty will be satisfied.
Many of you would love to see more of your prayers answered. You'd be a fool to say no, wouldn't you? There are things in this life that we have to understand. If we can go through this life ignorant, but we will achieve nothing. But when it comes to fulfilling the plan and purpose that God has for us, there are things that we have to understand. They don't come automatically. We have to seek them out. The first thing that we must understand is that there is an ancient story that affects everything. And that was an event in heaven. It's not just a story. There was rebellion in heaven, and Satan and the fallen angels were kicked out of heaven. We must understand that if we're going to make sense of life. The second thing is that we must understand God's original plan and purpose for man on the earth, and how he rebelled against God. And he was kicked out of the garden. that affects us, and we must understand it. And the thing that ties it all together, the third thing, is that God had a redemption plan. Amen? That Jesus would come and restore what was lost. And if we don't understand that, and we don't understand these things, our life will remain in confusion. And just, what's the point? Because everything we do will be hard. But everything is governed by these things, and everything is governed by the what happens in the spirit realm. We are first and foremost spirit. We have a soul, and we live in a body. The body, as you could say, is the least. It's only a tent. It's only a physical body that is temporary. It won't last. And we have a time on this earth. The more we look after that body, once that body goes, our time in this earth is over. Is that right? Whether we have completed the plan and purpose of God or not, if this body doesn't last, we're not going to finish the course. So there are only two sources of influence that affect man. One, the kingdom of God. Praise God. The kingdom of God, the highest authority of truth. He is superior to all things. He is God all by himself. There is nothing to compare him with. Jesus came and said, the kingdom of God is like this. It's like this. It's like this. It's like this. We cannot exhaust the knowledge of the kingdom of God. Amen. And then the other influence that influences man is the kingdom of darkness. And make no mistake, they are not equal. Light does not equal darkness. Not in the natural and not in the spiritual. God's kingdom is legal and superior in every way. He is light, and in him there is no darkness. The kingdom of darkness is fallen. The kingdom of darkness is illegal on the earth and operating under the control that man gives him. Or gives them. If we do not understand these things, we will be confused and we will live in chaos. So our fleshly man, our heart must choose, which influence am I going to submit to? Because if we do not submit 100% to God and his ways, we remain under the control of sin. There is a grace and a mercy that is available to us every day as we're growing and as we're walking in the ways of God. Yes, but if we do not develop and if we do not completely lay aside and say, I am not being influenced. Remember what in Romans it says, you are no longer a slave to sin. You're no longer slave to sin. But so many, even of God's people, are still living in that slavery. They're not experiencing the fullness of God. They're not entering into the fullness of their inheritance in Christ. Why? Because it's quite simple. As one famous preacher is well known for saying, get rid of sin before sin gets rid of you. See, a lot of people think, well, this sin, it's not going to keep me out of heaven, but it's keeping you from something that God has for you. You see, grace covers, but never blesses sin. We must understand this. There's nothing just happens in this world. Think about the law of the land. The law of the land is there, but is it enforced automatically? No, it has to be enforced. Even knowing the law of the land doesn't automatically enforce it. But there are channels of authority whereby it is enforced. Is that right? Does that make sense? God's law is perfect. It cannot be broken. And until we get a revelation of that, we will not fully walk in the liberty wherewith he has set us free. But like the law of gravity, it can't be broken. It can be violated. So if I jump off a cliff, the law of gravity still remains. It's not broken. It's still strong. It still stands. But I have violated it. And by choosing to step off that cliff, I have chosen death. Is that right? The consequence. You see, if we were to think that way, when I choose to violate the law of God, I'm choosing death. Because the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Full stop. That's it. It doesn't need any explanation. The consequence of sin. But grace, you see, the grace and the mercy of God keeps us from dying completely. And we may think, oh, I'm getting away with it. You're not getting away with it. Something is dying. And the thing that probably is dead is the plan and purpose of God for your life, because it cannot live while you're under that control of that sin, while you're violating the law of God. God is love. And I've seen this recently. A lot of people, they're dismissing everything about the gospel because God is love. And if God is love, man can't sin. How foolish. Are they living in Mars? They're not living in the real world. Sin is real. But the love of God is perfect. That means, and God says it, I will discipline those I love. You see, God is perfect love, and in perfect love, he is perfectly just. Again, we must understand that. Justice and mercy met at Calvary. And the way of escape was made for us, and we call it grace. That's why we live in the day of grace. Amen. See, Jesus has become our advocate. He has become the one who speaks for us, the one who stands before the Father. And he speaks for us. He intercedes for us. If you read the book of Job, and many people will quote things from the book of Job, but you must read it from this understanding that the book of Job shows what it was like when there was nobody to stand before the Father, when there was nobody to pay the price, when there was no advocate. And the wisdom that they had, they talked, there's chapter after chapter, and they went round and round, and they said, we know this, and we know this, but why is this? And that's like today. Men are still reasoning with the human mind. But Job kept saying this one thing. If only there was someone who could stand before the Creator and speak for me. And that's the message of Job. That was before the plan of salvation. That's what our life would be like without Jesus. But we have an advocate, and he's making intercession for us. You see, most Christians know about these things. They've heard about them. They have this information, but they don't comprehend what these things mean. And that leads to a life that is powerless, lacks direction. There's little or no victory over sin. What do you often hear? We're all sinners. We're going to sin every day. One preacher I know, he said, I don't have time to sin. I'm preaching the word every day. He holds prayer meetings every day. He doesn't have time to sin. And we can be like that, commitment. And you see, the lack of understanding leads to no spiritual maturing. No progress. And that leads to no testimony. We can deceive ourselves all we like, but God has called us first and foremost to be a living testimony of his glory. Yes. Last week, Dad began to look at Hannah's prayer, and I thought, he's going to share my message that I was planning. But he went in a different He started the same place and ended in a different place. So I'm just going to continue on from that today. You see, Hannah had prayed for many years, and we don't know how long she had prayed, but we know she had cried to God. Her prayers weren't being answered. She was sincere. She really desired a son. But until she connected with God's heart and God's desire, she did not get her prayer answered. See, Hannah desired a child, but God also desired a child. Because as Daddy had told us about Eli the priest and his two sons, they had sinned beyond the point of no repentance. You see, God never sends destruction without an opportunity to repent. Even on the old covenant, that's how he worked. But Eli and his two sons pushed it and pushed it and kept on pushing it. And what does it say? The wages of sin is death. So some say would say, oh, but God killed them. No, their sin. They chose death over life. But Hannah committed herself. If a mother is going to give up her child that she has desired, that's real commitment. I call that real commitment. Hannah committed herself, not only the child, to God. She laid down her desires and connected with the heart of God. You see, God needed, if the priest and his family were going to be cut off, God needed someone to speak, because that was the old covenant. If he didn't have someone pure, someone clean to hear, then Israel was doomed. So she connected with that need. And you could say she connected with a kingdom purpose. Because the priest in those days was the connection between God and his kingdom. What did he say? Israel, you're a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are my kingdom on the earth. So Hannah connected herself with the kingdom purpose. And that's a message for us today. We connect, when we begin to connect our prayers with God's kingdom agenda, we will see things change. We can cry like Hannah for years and years and not see our prayers answered. But the moment that we connect, something happens. See, God honors commitment. He hates half-heartedness. Half-heartedness, no commitment is useless. It's unreliable. Even the devil requires commitment. Do you know, whenever he doesn't lift anyone, he doesn't give them fame until he gets something first. They have to commit something to him before he'll do anything. And that's not like God, but yet Jesus said, be hot or be cold. But if you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. Or vomit you out. That's strong words, isn't it? So let's look at this legal prayer. James 5, verse 16. It says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Or another translation puts it this way, the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful deeds. That's what we want to be like in these days. That's what God requires. That is a kingdom requirement for every child of God. And it gives us the example. It says Elijah was as human as we are. And yet when he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, none fell for 3.5 years. Then when he prayed again, the sky began to yield its crops. So we're going to look at this legal requirement called prayer. There is a religious prayer and there's a legal prayer. Every religion prays, but they don't expect to get anything. It's a ritual. But when the child of God connects with the kingdom of God, it's a legal activity. And again, this does not come naturally. You don't just because you're born again know how to pray. It's taught. There's principles to prayer. Think about the law of the land again. Just because you know what the law says doesn't mean you can do anything about it. You have to go to someone who's been trained, someone who knows how to present that law, how to speak that language, and where to go. Is that right? You see, the main thing that we must know about legal prayer, most people will give you the definition of prayer. It's communication with God. It's talking with God. But that's not 100% right. It is the communion and communication with God that touches the heart of God. That's intimacy. That should be up there on the screen. So I want you to repeat that. What is prayer? Legal prayer. Can you see that it's much more than just 3 minutes, 5 minutes? Something you add to the end of your day? Something that you do as you're pulling on your socks and your shoes? If you're going to touch the heart of God, it takes time and it takes commitment. See, mostly we want God to come and change, come and fix it. And even when people come to prayer, they've said to me, well, why can't God just do it? Why can't God just change it? It's not how he works. See, by touching the heart of God, he changes us. And then he changes everything around us. Legal prayer is really finding out what God's heart of the matter is. See, how many times have we wasted time because we have been asking God to do something that we think needs to be done and we haven't connected with his desire? And then when we find his heart in the matter, we meditate on that, we get it until it connects with our spirit. And then, this is the amazing thing that happens, once that connection happens, then his word becomes our word. Not our word becoming his word. His word in us. His word working mightily in me until Christ be formed in me. Then what comes out of my mouth will be according to his word. We as humans want it the other way round. We take a promise of God and we think we have the right. I will speak that and I'll declare it and I'll decree it. If you haven't connected with it in authority and you don't know that that's what God says about this matter, then you have no right to take his word. But when we're connecting with it, can you see the difference? I don't have the words to fully explain that. I just hope you get that. God's word is not to be used. God's word is to become alive in it and us. When religious prayer is reporting the problems to God, it's just a list. But the legal prayer is not taking the problem to God, it's bringing the solution from heaven to the earth. Remember what Jesus said? Let your will be done. That's what he prayed. Where? On earth. Amen. And not only on earth, he says, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Who has the final word in heaven? When God speaks something, that's what it is. There is no question, there's no doubting, there's no discussion. If God says, it's that, it is that. Amen. See, Elijah didn't just turn up and say there's going to be no rain and it's not going to rain until I say so. And if we isolate the story of Elijah from the rest of the Bible, or we don't understand the scriptures, it may seem that way. But when we read the Bible, we have to ask these questions. So I was reading about Elijah. I said, Lord, why did he say there's going to be no rain? Because it didn't tell us God told him to say that. So you ask these questions and God will give you the answer. And the answer is this: Elijah had a legal ground to say there will be no rain. And it is found in Deuteronomy 11, verses 16 to 17. And I'm just bringing the one scripture for the sake of time. You can study it for yourself. You can go into depth. But Moses, given the instructions to the people of Israel directly from God, he said, I'm taking the people into the promised land. But this is their instructions when they get there. So God said through Moses to the people, be careful. Don't let your heart be deceived, so that you can turn away from the Lord and serve and worship other gods. If you do, say that. That's clear, isn't it? If you do, the Lord's anger will burn against you. He will shut up the sky and hold back the rain. What did he say would happen if they worshipped other gods? So when Elijah stood before Ahab, this is where the grounding that he was standing on. The rest of that verse says, and the ground will fail to produce its harvest. Then you will quickly die in the good land the Lord has given you. Commit yourself wholeheartedly to these words. Elijah committed himself wholeheartedly to these words. He connected with the heart of God. And we read in 1 Kings chapter 16, the end of chapter 16, that Ahab became king in Israel, and that he did more to provoke God than any other king. He married Jezebel and her idols. He set up temples in Israel for Baal and for Asherah. And he caused the people of Israel to worship idols. The thing that God said, do not do it. Remember, if you do. So we take up this story in 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1. Elijah told the king Ahab, as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, the God I serve. He's making a distinction. There will be no dew or rain during the next few years until I give the word. You see how it seems as if he was saying there's going to be no rain. He had connected. So the word of God was now his word. He had read, if Israel turns and worships idols, there will be no rain. So that's why he could say to the king, there will be no rain, because according to the word of God, and because we know that God does not send destruction without an opportunity to repent, we know that Ahab had an opportunity to repent and didn't take it. Israel had an opportunity to return to God and didn't return. They were going fast in idolatry and not taking time to consider their ways. And that's when God sends his word. And the prophet does not turn up. The prophet sounds so stern, so strict. The prophet is carrying the word of God. And the heart of the prophet is to turn the heart of the people back to God. And we know there was many things happened in those 3.5 years. But remember this, God kept Elijah. He didn't suffer. And nobody that met him suffered either. It's a wonderful story. But we're going to take it up in the next chapter, in chapter 18 and verse 1. And it says, later on in the third year of the drought, the Lord said to Elijah, go and present yourself to King Ahab. Tell him that I will soon send the rain. Now the story at this stage is Ahab is still searching for Elijah. He was searching to take him out but couldn't find him. God kept him all that time, and he couldn't find him. But now God's saying, you go to him. Now's the time for the rain to come. And I love this, because it says then in verse 17 of the same chapter, when Ahab saw him, he exclaimed, so is it really you, you troublemaker of Israel? How come the child of God is always the troublemaker? They're not really. Verse 18, I have made no trouble for Israel, replied Elijah. You and your family are the troublemakers. You refuse to obey the commands of the Lord and have worshipped the images of Baal instead. He's saying, that's why there's no rain. You chose the drought over the blessing. You chose the curse over the blessing. You chose death over life. Amen? And then he says, now summon all Israel to join me at Mount Carmel, along with the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who are supported by Jezebel. So Ahab summoned all the people of Israel and the prophets to Mount Carmel. Then Elijah stood in front of them and said, how much longer will you waver, hobbling between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, then follow him. And the people were completely silent. That's what we need today. We need people to get the word of God, to take the word of God, connect with it and speak it, and it will bring people to silence. And then after he told them what to do with the altars and everything else in verse 24, then he said, call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire is the true God. And the people all agreed. Once again, it does not tell us that God told Elijah to do that. But this is the amazing thing. When God said to Elijah, go to Ahab and tell him the rain's coming, Elijah knew something. The people are ready to repent. Because he knew repentance comes before the rain. Because according to 2 Chronicles in chapter 7, where God had promised Solomon, he said, if I shut the heavens and there is no rain, God knew what was going to happen. He knew the people would rebel. And he made provision for it. That's the grace of God. And people wonder, why does God allow bad things to happen? It's not his will. It was never his will. But these things happen. But in his grace and in his mercy, he always provides a way out. Say that. God always provides a way out for me. There's always a way of escape. And he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and restore and heal their land and forgive their sins. So Elijah knew the people are ready to repent. And I love it because he said to Ahab, summon all the people. He didn't go out through the land. He didn't run crusades. He said, you get everyone here because I have something to say. And when we were in prayer on Tuesday, I heard that there's something come. I don't understand. In my mind, in my spirit, I've grasped it, but I haven't yet got the fullness. But something is going to happen, that God is going to call together nations. And one thing he's going to bring. And I remembered the prophecy years ago that was given here that there would be a confrontation. And it was referring to this, the same as what happened here with Elijah. He didn't have the internet to get to everybody. He didn't have TV to broadcast it. But if a nation goes to a war, the king or the president or whoever, they can get on every channel at one time and reach a whole nation at once. Is that true? God has never changed. That's a God thing. He did it many times. But Elijah knew this. If rain's coming, repentance is coming. See, God always calls the end from the beginning. He gives you the destination first. Just like he said to Moses at the burning bush, you're going to go and you're going to bring my children out of slavery and they're going to come to this mountain and worship me. And then when Moses was on his way, he told him, Pharaoh's not going to listen. Pharaoh's not going to let them go. You're going to have to do this. You're going to have to do that. And when God gives us our destination, it's like what Daddy said last week. When Jesus said, you're going to the other side, they were going to the other side. Regardless of what happened in between, the word of the Lord still stood. Amen? Have you grasped that reality that what God has spoken, he will do? And what you do in between relies on how committed you are to hearing his voice and how obedient you are to follow his instruction. So Elijah had not only a word from the Lord, he had connected to the heart of God so that the word of God had become his word. Amen. That's why it says that there was be no rain until Elijah said, because Elijah had connected with the heart of God. And after the fire fell and the people repented and turned back to God, then Elijah said, now it will rain, because that's what God had said would happen. But he still had to pray seven times. And then he saw that cloud of the, or his servant saw the cloud the size of a man's hand in the sky. That's not much. Even we know in this land, that's not going to bring much rain. We know when there's rain in the sky. But Elijah knew that was all he needed. He girded himself up and he ran with speed, outrunning the king in his horse and chariot. That's supernatural strength. Amen. Jesus told us, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things that you have need of will be added to you. And many people think that's getting saved. That's coming to Jesus. Seeking the kingdom is not the priority of the unsaved. Getting saved in the first place is the priority of an unbeliever, accepting that Jesus Christ is king. But when we believe, and when Jesus is our king, then our priority is to seek first, pursue after, to understand God and his righteousness, his ways. You see that we have been given the position of righteousness. It is true that we have been made the righteousness of God through Christ. That is true. That's our position. But there's a path of righteousness that we must walk in. There are many violating and abusing their position of righteousness, just like grace and like authority. Many want God's promises and his intervention, but are we willing to get God's heart? Are we willing to sit down long enough to get the heart of God? Remember what prayer was? To touch the heart of God, to learn his ways, to be meditating upon his word, to be filling our lives. See, remember this and never forget it, that everything has a source. So what are you filling yourself with? Many Christians today are full of the agenda of the Antichrist and the worldly systems, instead of being filled with the end time agenda of the kingdom. Are you serious about God answering your prayers? You see, Elijah was not finished when he went to Ahab and said there's going to be no rain. He wasn't finished whenever he stood in Mount Carmel and the fire fell and the people repented. He wasn't finished when he killed the 850 prophets, false prophets, by himself. What strength No man could do that on his own. He wasn't even finished when he said, "It's going to rain." He wasn't even finished whenever he outran Ahab and his horse and chariot. He should have went straight to the palace and taken Jezebel out with her prophets, but he didn't. But I want to tell you that Elijah, although we can learn from him, he is not our example. Jesus is our example. That was under the old covenant, and we are under the new covenant. And although the principles still stand, we are under this covenant that Jesus fulfilled his purpose. What did he say? "I have come to destroy the works of the devil. I have come, this is my purpose, to restore what was lost." And when he was on that cross, ready to take his last breath, what did he say? His last words. "It is finished." He fulfilled God's purpose from beginning to end without fail. And he said, "It is finished. Justice is fully paid. The new covenant is made." Amen. And that's where we come. So I want to say to you, no matter how much prayers you have answered, how much success you have, how much you feel that you're doing well, there's more. There's more commitment. And what we were singing today, "More, Lord. I must have more." You see, God wants to give us more. And it's like we go through this thing in our garage where it fills up. And then we clear it all out. And then it fills up again. But you know, if something is full, there's no room for anything else. Is that true? And if we're full of the wrong stuff, God can't get what he wants to us. But if we remove it and think of it this way, we lay aside sin, right? We cast it off. We choose. No. But true brokenness before the Father goes deeper. And that is coming to the heart of the Father, coming to that communion with him, and actually laying down everything we are. Even our God-given desires, even the promises that God has given us. See, many are running and they're standing on the promise. But what I have learned in my own life, that standing on the promise, there's no guarantee. But when I bring that promise, I give that desire, I give that dream, I have to commit what I do to the Lord. I lay it down. The Bible talks about we will cast our crowns before him. And you see, until there's total surrender, until there is total commitment, we have not experienced true brokenness. But in that true brokenness, where we say, "Okay, Lord, I've been doing things my way. I've got this plan. What I'm doing is good, and it's a working for you." Until you give it to the Lord, it's not his. It's still yours. So a ministry may not be given to the Lord. A life may not be fully committed. But what he does is, because we have removed everything else and we're lying there, we're a clean vessel. And we're a vessel that he said, "Okay, now I'll fill you with my word. I'll make you," what's the Bible say? "Present yourself a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto the Lord." This is not the type of preaching that people want to hear. But we are all in a time when, and I heard this back in 2019, "You get in my presence and you stay in my presence." And I felt a wee bit like Elijah at the brook. A wee bit like just, you know, feasting and drinking from that water. But what the Lord showed me this morning, during the night, there's an exposure coming. And again, I don't know how that's coming, but I saw many who had the name of the Lord, but there was so much hidden sin. And that was almost as if the curtains were being pulled back, like a bit like Elijah going to Ahab and saying, this idolatry, it cannot reign. That's what he was saying. Because of this idolatry, it cannot reign. And as we're in a stage whenever, it's almost as if the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness has taken a hold of everything that belongs to them and taken that formation. And we see in the world that people are, what the devil owns, he's going to take. That's the bottom line. But what God owns, what we surrender to him, he's going to lift. And he is going to move. So we want to be partaking of the provision of God, the protection of God, the blessing of God. We better make sure that we're completely clean before him. That we say anything of the devil, it's not going to, I'm not giving it place. I'm separating myself. And that's what repentance is. Repentance is not, I'm sorry, Lord, for my sin and then do it again tomorrow. No, repentance is, this is me doing the sin. This is me repenting. My sin's there and I'm walking to God. I'm going his way. So what my prayer for you is, will we be able to say, like Paul, I have run the race. I've fought the good fight of faith. And like Jesus said, whenever we enter heaven, will we hear those words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen.
Amen. If you've been listening to this on the internet, many people are heavily involved in religious organizations, absolutely no knowledge of the salvation of the Lord. You've been listening today, this is your day. You come to the Lord Jesus Christ and you repent. Believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We're living on a day when we need to be ready because we see all the signs around us of the second coming of Jesus Christ. But before that'll happen, there'll be a rapture. There'll be a catching up of God's people. We're not looking for the Antichrist, we're looking for the real Christ. And the only way to be ready is to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and give your life to him. If you want to call in the name of the Lord, I would pray a short prayer. If you want to pray this sincerely, then I want to pray for you that God will lead you and guide you and meet your every need. So if you want to give your life to the Lord today, just a simple prayer, really sincere from the heart. Lord Jesus Christ, I repent of all my sins. I turn away from it, and Lord Jesus, I call upon you to be my Lord and be my Savior. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that you are the Son of God. You are the only way. You're the only truth and you're the only life. So I'm asking you, Lord Jesus Christ, to forgive me all my sin and come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Father God, I pray for those that will call upon you through this message. Lord, there's those, Lord, that have never known you. Lord, buried in religion and self-destruction. Lord, there's those that have walked away from the truth. They've been deceived by religious leaders that don't know you, Lord, or know your word. So, Father God, I'm praying for these people today, Lord, that they will have a divine encounter with you today. Lord, for those that have called upon you for the first time, I pray, Lord, that you will reveal yourself to them in a new way, that they will know, Lord, that they've been redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. And Father, for those that have been deceived, Lord, and taken out of the way by religious leaders, false doctrines, traditions of man, Lord, I pray that you will reveal yourself to them today. I pray, Lord, that all these people, Lord, will hear your voice saying, this is the way, walk in it. And Father, I'm asking you in Jesus' name, Lord, that you will lead them, you'll guide them, Lord, and they'll find a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church where they'll be taught the Word of God. I pray, Father God, for those, Lord, that have a need in their body today. Lord, I speak to their body, Lord, because we know that Jesus not only bore their son on the cross, he bore all the sickness and the disease and the curse of the enemy. And Father, I pray healing fire of God to burn through them from head to toe. I pray, Lord, that they will know the hand of God upon them right now in Jesus' name. And Father, that will have a mighty testimony. Lord, I come against cancers today, and I curse that destructive spirit of cancer. And I cast it out of all these bodies in the name of Jesus. I come against arthritis and asthma, all these diseases that hinder. And I praise you, Lord, that you bore it all on the cross. And I list these people to receive their healing today in Jesus' name. And Father God, I pray for our land today. Lord, that there'll be a breaking free of the religious systems and the doctrines of devils. Lord, there'll be fires of revival, not only in our land, but in our nation and in the world. And Father, we ask you for Israel today. We ask you, Lord, for their protection. We pray, Lord, for peace in Jerusalem. Lord, for it's a command in your word. And we're praying peace in Jerusalem. And we bind all demon activity going on around them today. Lord, that their eyes will be opened, that they'll see Jesus. Lord, I pray that your hand will be revealed in Israel today and around the place. Lord, there'll be news on the televisions and the airways today, Lord, of the hand of God. Lord, just like you come down, Lord, and deliver them out of Egypt. And I pray, oh God, that not only will you bring them out of this bondage, this slavery, but they'll bring them into the center of your will. They'll come to know you, Lord. And Father God, for those demon-possessed men that are coming against them, I pray salvation, healing, deliverance. Lord, that this world will know that you're on the throne. Lord, there'll be many, Lord, come to know you in these days. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that you've met every need. And we pray, Lord, for those that don't have that revelation today. And pray, Lord, they'll turn unto you and love and see their need met in Jesus' name. And Father, we're asking you for household salvations. Lord, we know the days are short. We know, Lord, we could be caught up out of this world any day. Lord, We're not looking for the Antichrist, we're looking for you. And Father God, I pray that we will see many won for you in these days. Lord, as we part from one another in this house today, Lord, we'll not part for you, Lord, for you said you'd never leave us nor forsake us. We pray, Lord, you'll lead us and guide us and direct us in these days, that we will see the name of Jesus uplifted and glorified. And Father God, we'll be careful to give you all the praise, give you all the glory. And God's people said, amen.
Amen.
And shouted, hallelujah. Amen. Praise God.